Respected seniors and colleagues, good morning. Myself, Dr. Mangal Dave, consultant anesthesiologist and head of department of anesthesia at Gokul Hospital, Rajkot. And I have been practicing since 18 years. My main work in neuro, spine, trauma, and high-risk anesthesia cases. And today, I'm going to give a lecture on posterior fossa surgery anesthesia, clinical pulse. According to the skull-based divisions, the cranial fossa is divided into anterior, middle, and posterior cerebral fossa. And the largest of three cranial fossa is the posterior fossa. And the contents are cerebellum, large portion of brainstem, lower midbrain, pons, and medulla. It also contains 3 to 12 cranial nerves and its nuclei, and other important efferent and efferent pathways of nervous system. The boundaries of posterior fossa, anteriorly it is bound by dorsum sellae, sphenoid and basilar part of occipital bone, posteriorly by squamous part of occipital bone, laterally with petrous and mastoid part of temporal bone, superiorly by tent or tentorium cerebelli, and the base is found by occipital bone. The clinical significance is posterior fossa is a compact and rigid compartment and it has poor compliance. And a small addition in volumes, like with hemorrhage or a space-occupying lesion within the posterior fossa, can result in significant elevation of compartment pressure, leading to life-threatening brainstem compression. CSF pathway in cerebral aqueduct is also very narrow and cause obstruction of it can cause hydrocephalus and raise intracranial pressure. Therefore, anesthesia for posterior fossa surgeries presents significant challenges. What are the indications for posterior fossa surgery? Posterior fossa surgery indication mainly is tumors. Tumor is the commonest pathology. Especially pediatric patient, almost 60% are tumors. Although there can be arteriovenous malformations, aneurysms, cerebellar hematoma or infarct, or for microvascular decompression of trigeminal neuralgia or femifacial spasm, or craniocervical abnormalities like atlanto-axial or atlanto-occipital instability, and Arnold-Chiari malformations. Which are the different positions given for posterior fossa surgery? There can be supine with head turn position, lateral park bench position, prone, and most of the important sitting position. This is the picture showing supine with head turned to one side, head is turned to opposite side, and placement of sandbag under the ipsilateral shoulder to minimize stretching of brachial plexus is given. This position is mainly utilized for MVD or microvascular decompression, for example, for trigeminal neuralgia, hemifacial spasm, and glossopharyngeal neuralgia. And CP angle tumors also can be done in this position. Lateral position. The patient is turned to lateral side and pressure points are protected with soft pillows. And head is rested on either sandbag or horseshoe or with pin. The advantage of the position is it provides drainage of blood and CSF with gravity, and the amount of retraction is reduced. Park bench position is a little modification of lateral position. Here the head is little more flexed and it facilitates access to midline structures, but due care should be taken to avoid pressure at pressure points. Prone position. The patient is completely made prone and he lies on bolsters. The head is either fixed with pin system or horseshoe also can be utilized. This position is used for all midline tumors, AVM, aneurysm, etc. When the horseshoe is used, care should be taken for eyes and pressure points and abdominal pressure. To minimize abdominal pressure and surgical bleeding, horseshoe and bolsters are used, so there is no undue pressure on abdomen. On the right side, you can see the photograph of real surgery going on with the position of anesthesia workstation and surgeon and assistant working on microscope. Again, photographs of actual surgery. The patient is made prone. There is a tongue applied with traction and the head is resting on horseshoe. You can see the padding in front of eyes to protect from any pressure and see how the patient is fixed over bolsters. The another photograph is showing the surgery and microscope in situ. Sitting position. Sitting position has its own advantages, factors affecting anesthesia and outcome. Sitting position gives good access and comfort to the surgeon. Blood and CSF drains from surgical site. It gives advantage of gravity. The light and position gives easier access to midline structures to the surgeon, but it causes postural hypotension. So patient of extreme age, cardiac or respiratory compromise need to be avoided. From anesthesiologist perspective, the position, sitting position should only be given in a good setup with adequate facilities are there. There should be enough monitoring and proper workstation available and with experienced and trained surgical team should be there. Complications in sitting position are potentially very dangerous and difficult to handle. Contraindication of sitting position. The absolute contraindications are ventriculoatrial or VA shunt of brain or right to left heart shunt, cervical spine instability or fractures. Relative contraindications are patent foramen ovale, uncontrolled hypertension, extremes of age, and severe autonomic dysfunction. Now this picture is showing how we give a sitting position at our setup. This is the operation table. The patient is made induced in supine condition, supine position, and gradually the table is head and is elevated 15 to 20 degree for every 2 to 3 minutes to make the patient sitting. And the pillows are placed below the knees and under the arms for placement of the patient. We should be fixing the anesthesia circuit and monitors properly so that there is no disconnection or dislodgement of circuits. Because intraoperatively, we get very little access to the patient. This is where the anesthesia workstation lies and the patient position. Once the patient is made sitting, the head pins and the frame is applied to the patient. And this is how the surgeon stands and the trolleys will be placed to give a fair idea of anesthesia workstation. We get a very little access to the patient as such. So everything needs to be fixed in advance. Because once the patient is draped, we lost the vision. You know, we have a very little access and everything is under monitor care. So this is the ultimate position, how the anesthesia workstation, the surgical instruments and the microscope and the surgeon and assistant positions will be there. This is the actual patient, female of young age. On the left, you can see the padding under the chin of the patient to avoid any undue flexion of the neck and soiling of body through saliva. The ghost piece or gamgee is placed, the pillow in the lap of the patient, and the on the right of photograph you can see the crepe bandage application to improve venous return to the patient. Again, photographs of surgeries in sitting position. On the left is being operating with naked eyes. On the right side, it is the surgery under microscope. And you can see the position of anesthetist and anesthesia workstation in the right photograph, and where the instrument trolleys and assistants are standing. We are sitting very much away from the head end. Anesthetic considerations for posterior fossa surgeries. Thorough evaluation of the preoperative neurological condition and cardiorespiratory status are important for safe conduct of anesthesia for posterior fossa surgeries. Preoperative evaluation include evaluation of cerebellar and cranial nerve dysfunction. Presence of lower cranial nerve compression and dysfunction can cause loss of gag reflex. Some of the patients of posterior fossa may already have loss of gag reflex, and it can cause aspiration. So in these patients, care should be taken either to do tracheostomy or post-op ventilation in this like patient. Evaluation of cardiorespiratory compliance. Compromised cardiorespiratory function can lead to hemodynamic instability and poor prognosis. So in these patients with poor cardiorespiratory reserve, sitting cannot be given. Other position also given with very much caution. Evaluation of hydration in electrolytes. Preoperatively, the patient's hydration should be good and electrolyte to be normalized. Evaluation of intraoperative positioning. That is, we have to analyze which position we need to give and whether the patient is fit for that position or not. For example, obese patient will be difficult to give prone position, and cardiorespiratory compromised position will be a relative contraindication for sitting position. Evaluation of airway. Some of the patients will have restricted neck movement, or they can have ankylosis spondylitis and difficult intubations. Anesthesia technique. The goals of anesthesia management in posterior fossa surgery is to maintain intracranial pressure and cerebral perfusion, to maintain hemodynamic stability, and early detection and treatment of any complication if occur. For this, we have to avoid cardiorespiratory compromised patients and extremes of age. We have to take good large bore IV lines or central line. If it is there, it is better. There should be a smooth induction. We can use propofol and scolin or any relaxant of your choice. Intubation, if you have armor tube or that is better. Proper fixation of tube and monitor and taking care of lines while giving position is also important. Proper eye cover and padding to prevent organ damage and eye damage. Crepe bandage application on lower limbs to improve the venous return. And once the patient is induced, there should be a gradual and slow elevation from supine to sitting to avoid any sudden hypotension. And we do like 15 to 20 degree elevation and waiting for 2 to 3 minutes for the patient to settle, and then again doing further elevation. The monitoring is done by ECG, non-invasive blood pressure, SpO2, and tidal carbon dioxide is must for all sitting position. Maintenance can be done with oxygen, air, and sevoflurane. Sitting position to maintain blood pressure, mean blood pressure of above 80 millimeter of mercury. Nitrous oxide is best avoided in sitting position. Control of blood pressure if hypertension can be done with nitroglycerin or labetalol drips. Invasive BP monitoring, if it is available, it is good. Indwelling urinary catheter should be done to measure urine output. Temperature monitoring when there is a longer duration surgery is causing hypothermia should be done. Neurological monitoring of electroencephalogram or EEG can be used to detect cerebral hypoperfusion and cortical ischemia. SSEP or somatosensory evoked potential can be done monitoring to monitor spinal cord ischemia. We have to intraoperatively maintain normovolemia. If there is blood loss, we must be giving blood and crystalloid accordingly. Analgesia, tramadol and paracetamol analgesia with local infiltration. Phentalene and dexmedetomidine can be used to it, and also it will help reduce the blood pressure. After the surgery, there should be gradual supination from sitting position to avoid any hypertension. And once we are doing supination, we have to take care that the lines are not stretching or they are not pulled off. Don't hesitate to shift the patient in an ICU or ventilator, because these patients are likely to develop macroglossia if there is any stormy surgical course and likely damage to any lower cranial nerves. We should be ventilating the patients postoperatively. Posterior fossa SSG is having very low compliance and it gives very less time to intervene if any complications occur. So better we prevent all the complications. Postoperative management. Extubation will be depending on the preoperative condition of the patients and intraoperatively course. The patient who was intact preoperatively and had an uneventful surgery, there can be a smooth emergence and extubation can be carried out. Otherwise, postoperatively ventilation can be done. PONV, postoperative nausea vomiting. All patients of posterior fossa surgery are considered at high risk of PONV because of proximity of vomiting center to the surgical site. Complications are many in posterior fossa surgeries. Excessive bleeding and damage to vital structures during surgery can occur, and we should be prepared with adequate supply of blood. Endotracheal tube or lines dislodgement, accidental extubation can be there during surgery. Air embolism. Small to large amount of air entering into venous system from surgical site can lead to air embolism. And we should be always vigilant, and it is detected by sudden fall in ETCO2, hypotension. On auscultation at a later stage, there will be mill-wheel murmur. The treatment is supportive, 100% oxygen and irrigation of surgical site with saline and saline soap goes. Suspected air entry points are sealed. Head level should be made low, below the heart if possible. Discontinue nitrous oxide if it is going on. Vasopressor and suppressive treatment needs to be done. Macroglossia or enlarged tongue. As a result of obstruction of venous and lymphatic drainage, there will be macroglossia and it can cause postoperatively respiratory obstruction, damage to eyes, nose, and pressure effect from positioning. Pneumocephalus. If air is entering in cranial cavity, it can present as pneumocephalus, and in recovery, there is a delayed recovery, there is agitation of the patient postoperatively, confusion, and the diagnosis is made by CT scan and treated accordingly. High flow oxygen can be given. If there is much more pneumocephalus, Burholt should be done to remove excess air. Complication, quadriplegia. When there is a severe stretching of spinal cord with acute flexion for a prolonged time, it may cause a dangerous complications of quadriplegia to the patient. And in pediatric patient, there is a posterior fossa syndrome sometimes detected. It occurs in children and defined as a temporary and complete loss of speech in children after posterior fossa surgeries. To conclude, posterior fossa surgery in sitting position has its own advantage for patient and surgeon, but because of dangers associated with the sitting position, the popularity of sitting position is nowadays very much reducing. Though with meticulous planning and care, we can anesthetize the patient for posterior fossa surgery very safely. Thank you very much.